يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، so welcome back to our syllabus, Ink Pot to the Grave. And we are now, alhamdulillah, we have finished the first three books and we are now on the fourth book. We are now on the fourth book, which is الدروس المهمة لعامة الأمة, important lessons for the Muslims or for the general Muslims, by Sheikh Abdul Aziz Ibn Baz rahimahullah. And this is a very, very important book. And the explanation that we are going to be using is Sheikh Haytham Sarhan's explanation, just like we did for Usul al-Thalatha and al-Qawa'id al-Arba'ah. And I've sent the PDFs in the group, inshallah. And so without, you know, any delay, we'll start the book. Let me share screen. Okay, so this is the book, and this is what we are going to focus on. We're going to focus on this explanation. There are other explanations. Sheikh Abdul Razak al-Badr has an explanation which has been translated into English. Sheikh Abdul Karim al-Khudair, that's only Arabic. But what we're going to focus on is Sheikh Haytham Sarhan, and that's all we need for now. And that is all that we need for now. And as for buying the book, a lot of people asked, I talked to the Sheikh at the moment, they're trying to get it into stores. It's not in the stores. The Sheikh suggested that you just print out the PDFs for now. Like you just print out the PDFs for now. So we are going through this book, okay, which is titled The Important Lessons for Every Muslim, okay, by Sheikh Ibn Baz. And obviously this is the explanation by Sheikh Haytham Sarhan. And this is a great book written by a great imam, written by Al-Allama Abdul Aziz Ibn Baz, rahimahullah. And this book, as you can see, they've translated it into English as Every Muslim, but in Arabic, Ammat al-Ummah, I mean the general Muslims. So every Muslim, you know, should know what is in this book. So in here are the most important matters, the obligatory matters. Even if some of the matters in here are not obligatory, but they're mustahab and recommended, they are still from the most important ones which every Muslim should still know. Okay? And a lot of the time, you know, we all know the virtues of seeking knowledge. We all know the virtue of seeking knowledge. Just to remind ourselves of some of the virtues before we start this book, just one hadith. And this hadith is the hadith of Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. And in this hadith, you know, we don't have time to explain the whole hadith, but we'll just have a quick read. And there's a number of benefits and virtues for the seeker of knowledge, the one who seeks Islamic knowledge. So the Prophet ﷺ said, firstly, whoever follows a path in quest of knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make his path to Jannah easy for him. SubhanAllah, your path to Jannah will become easy for you. And then the angels lower their wings over the seeker of knowledge, being pleased with what he does. SubhanAllah, the angels lower their wings. Now some of the ulama differ in exactly what does it mean to lower the wings, but you know, we can understand that it's a great virtue. And the inhabitants of the heavens and the earth and even the fish in the depth of the oceans seek forgiveness for him. Everything in the heavens and the earth seek forgiveness for the seeker of knowledge. And the superiority over a learned man, over a devout worshipper. So which is better, one who worships Allah or one who seeks Islamic knowledge? This hadith is saying that the one who is seeking Islamic knowledge is superior over the worshipper, is like that of the full moon to the rest of the stars. Just like the differences between the moon and the rest of the stars. And the learned are the heirs of the prophets, i.e. the inheritors. They are the inheritors of the prophets. The ulama are the inheritors of the prophets. Because the prophets do not, you know, they do not leave back any dinar or dirham, but they only leave knowledge. And the one who acquires it has in fact acquired an abundant portion, meaning they have gained a lot of benefits. So, you know, it's very important for us to seek knowledge generally, but especially this book, because this book has those things in there which are the most important and the most obligatory. And subhanAllah, you'll find that a lot of, you know, even tulab al-ilm and ula, even some, you know, scholars as well, they'll give a lot of importance to teaching students of knowledge, but they'll neglect teaching the general people. They'll neglect teaching the general people. And this is a big area which we also have to give importance to. And Ibn Baz rahimahullah, he was alerted to this, hence he wrote this book. So I mean, this book, we're gonna see a lot of the book, a lot of the things in the book we have already kind of taken before. That's why it's easy. Okay, so those parts will be easy, and those parts which we have taken, you know, we can go over them quickly, inshallah, so we don't take too long on this book. But you know, after studying this book, teach it to your family, to your friends, to the general people. Teach it, because in here are the things which every Muslim should know. In here are the things which every Muslim should know. So if I actually start with the book, this is the, you know, introduction written by Ibn Baz. In here, he, you know, explains what this book is, and he starts off by saying, you know, all praises for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And well, before this, he says the basmala, which they've not translated into the English, but no issue, inshallah. The good end is for the obedient slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Arabic, it says al-muttaqun. So those who have the taqwa, those who have that fear and the God consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And, you know, a taqwa in simple terms is, you know, a shield which protects you from falling into that which is haram, and it makes you do those things which have been commanded to do. May Allah praise and send peace and blessings upon His slave and messenger, our Prophet Muhammad, and his family, and all of his companions. And now the Sheikh, he also sends salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is sunnah muakkada. Everybody should do so, and we know the rewards for it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever sends salutation upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once, sallallahu alaihi biha ashra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, will give him 10 rewards. So for one, you'll get 10 rewards back. And there's also a lot of many ahadith which dispraise the one who, when he hears the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, does not say sallallahu alaihi wasallam, such as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said the one who is stingy is the one who does not say sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he hears my name. And also the hadith of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he says, رَغِيمَ أَنْفُ, may the one perish who hears my name and he does not send salutations upon me. So it's something very, very important to start always with you know, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the author, he mentions, you know, the intent of this book, and he says, these words are about some obligations upon every Muslim regarding the religion, and I have named it the important lessons for every Muslim. So in here, he mentions, you know, what his intent is, which is that he's going to mention those issues which are the most important that every Muslim should know. And he's called it the important lessons for every Muslim. The name, you know, this book, as they say in English, it does what it says on the tin. Meaning, it's, you know, the name is correct to what is inside the book. These are important lessons for every Muslim to study. Now, why should we study these lessons? Why should we study? If somebody asks you, what's the importance of this book? Why should we study this book? Okay, there are two answers. Firstly, because, you know, we're beginners, and we have been commanded as beginners to go back to the people of knowledge. So the first reason is because the ulama have advised, just as the previous books that we have done. That's number one. The second is because these are important. These lessons are important. Okay, these lessons are important that every Muslim should know. Now, somebody may say that, okay, yeah, these are important lessons, but for Ammat al-Ummah, for the Awam, for the general Muslims, I'm a student of knowledge. Yeah, I don't need to study this book. I'll go to the bigger books. I'm going to go to Kitab al-Tuhid. I'm going to go to Wasatiyah. I'm going to go to the big one. I don't need this book. You know, what's this book? So the simple answer is, okay, no problem. Yeah, this book is for the Awam. But, you know, just come to me for a second. Let's test you what's inside this book. If we test you what's inside of this book, and you know, and you're able to answer, then you're more knowledgeable than the general Muslims, and you can move on to the bigger books. But if you fail, that means you're at the same level as the general Muslims, and you have to study this book. That's why one should not have takabbur, one should not have arrogance. Okay, these books the ulama have advised, a student of knowledge should study them. Okay, here, that's why, you know, Sheikh, he hates them. See, the yellow part is the writing of the author, and this white, the white part is the explanation of Sheikh Haytham. So he says, why do we study these important lessons? Because they are important, as the author has mentioned, so the scholars have advised us to study them. If it said they are important but for the beginners, whilst I am a student of knowledge, my level is above the common Muslims, the answer he or she should be tested. If he or she does not pass, then they are lower than the common Muslims. A student of knowledge should be humble and not think he or she is better than others. In Sahih Bukhari, he narrated that Mujahid said, a shy and arrogant person will not attain knowledge. That's something which is very important regarding this book. Now, if you want to summarize what's in this book, yeah, and another point we can mention here as well is, you know, in the Quran, Allah Ta'ala says, you know, "Kunu rabbaniin," be from the scholars who are rabbani, those who are wise, those who nurture the people. What does that actually mean, being a rabbani? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma is narrated, Bukhari mentions it mu'allaqan in his book. He says, they are those الذي يربي جميعا رب الناس بصغار العلم قبل كباره. They are the ones who nurture the people with the small knowledge before the big knowledge. Okay, the small knowledge before the big knowledge, because the small knowledge is that what they need. It's what's obligatory upon them. They need it on a day-to-day basis. As for the bigger knowledge, that's going to go over the heads. It's going to be complicated. They're not going to remember it. And do they actually need it at that time? Is it the most beneficial thing for them at that time? Okay, now we're going to move on to what this book actually consists of. Now, subhanAllah, if you look, you know, at what this book consists of and what we're going to take in this book, you'll realize how great this book is, inshallah. The first thing, so, you know, this book is seven parts. The first is the way the Salaf would read the Quran and memorize it and reflect upon it and act upon it. Okay, so you can maybe summarize the first one, how the Salaf were with the Quran. How the Salaf were with the Quran. And here we're gonna, you know, have a little small introduction. We'll take that today, and then tafsir of the ending surahs of the Quran. Okay, and don't worry, I'll talk about that at the end. Then number two, explanation of Islam, Iman, Ihsan, worshiping Allah, and the categories of shirk and worshiping other than Allah. Okay, so subhanAllah, and you know, most of what is in point number two, we have already taken in Usul al-Thalatha and Qawaid al-Arba. So when those points come again, we can just, you know, go through them quickly and we can move on. The third is the explanation of the prayer. Explanation of the prayer. And number four is explanation of wudu. And you can, subhanAllah, you can also add, you know, the five pillars or the remaining pillars of Islam. The remaining pillars of Islam. The Sheikh hasn't mentioned it, but in his explanation, the Sheikh just actually, I don't know if it's in the English. If it's not in the English, I'll mention it because it's in the Arabic. A bit of zakah. And also a bit of Hajj and fasting also. She should have a look if it's there. Let me have a quick look. Is there? Yeah, so you, as you can see here, zakah and fasting and Hajj and Umrah. Okay, so you guys can add that on, inshallah. Okay, and then the fifth part is beautifying oneself with Islamic manners. There's going to be a part talking about some of the mannerisms that every Muslim should uphold, and these are Islamic mannerisms that every Muslim should have. And number six, warning against the worship of other than Allah and categories of sins. So it's going to talk a little bit about sins also. And finally, it's going to talk about funeral prayers. So preparing the dead body, praying the funeral prayer, and burying it. Okay, so these are the seven. So inshallah, learn it like this. Keep it the same. We'll be number four, say explanation of wudu, ablution, and then the remaining pillars of Islam. Just maybe add that on. And then the remaining pillars of Islam. Because the prayer, you know, quite a bit is mentioned. And as for the other pillars, it's a bit more summarized. It's not as long as Salah. Now, those who listen to my Shurut al-Salah explanation or the Fiqh of Salah, as it's uploaded them to the channel, then, you know, this part will become a lot easier for you. So, you know, you're basically going to take the same thing. A few other things might be added. So this is what the book actually consists of, these seven parts. SubhanAllah, now you can understand how important this is. It has the Quran in there, it has the Aqeedah in here, it has fiqh, it has mannerisms. And something very, very important, mannerisms is part of one's Aqeedah. You know, Shaykh al-Islam in his Aqeedah al-Wasitiyah, at the end, he has a whole chapter just on mannerisms. Why? Aqeedah al-Wasitiyah is a book on Aqeedah. because mannerism is from the aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Okay, it's from the complete same mukammalat al-i'tiqad. It's from those things which complete one's beliefs. That's something very important. Okay, so why does the author himself, rahimahullah, start off with the basmala, with the name of Allah? Why does he start off with? Let me see what the Arabic is called. Yeah, bil basmala. Why does he start off with the basmala? Okay, and they might, I think, you know, writing basmala would be better because you can get confused with the alhamdulillah, etc. But this is translated, obviously, quite a few things need to be changed. Don't worry about it. The Sheikh, mashallah, what he does keep editing it, and he'll send them out. So if there's a new updated version, I'll send it into groups, inshallah. But this, you know, we've already taken, firstly, following the Book of Allah and the Prophet. Secondly, is following the Hadith, every important matter which does not begin with the name of Allah, then it is deficient, even though the narration is weak. I mean, even though it's weak, it's already been established that the person used to do it, and it's in the Book of Allah, we've taken this before. The Salaf would also do it, and it's also a means of seeking blessings and increasing goodness by starting with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is regarding, you know, before we go into the book. But start off at the beginning. Now, if you remember, the first part of the book is regarding the way of the Salaf when it comes to the Quran, the way of the Salaf when it comes to the Quran. So Sheikh Ibn Baz, what he says, what the person needs to know is the opening chapter, Surah Fatiha, and some short chapters from Surah Zalzala to An-Nas. Reading it correctly to a teacher, memorizing it, and knowing that which is obligatory to understand. So he's mentioning you need to know from Surah Fatiha and then Surah Zalzal, Surah An-Nas. And that's basically Qisar al-Mufassal, similar to what we took in the previous book. Okay, now, you know, we talked about the Mufassal, and the word Mufassal means, you know, those which have gaps in between the Basmala, you know, each surah has gaps. And some Surah Qaf, Surah An-Nas, and it's three types. It's the long Mufassal, which is Surah Qaf to Juz'am to Surah Naba, and then the middle, which is the medium, which is from just Surah Naba to Al-Duha, and then the short ones, Al-Duha to Surah An-Nas. Now, there is slight difference of opinion. Ibn Baz, rahimahullah, he has decided to mention from Surah Zalzala, which is not too far, Surah Zalzala to Surah An-Nas. And there's not a big issue in that. And, you know, there are other ahadith which could allude to starting with Zalzala. But, you know, the point being again that these surahs are from the most important surahs that everybody has memorized, they recite in the salah. And this is a good way of teaching as well. Like, you mention a few surahs, and this will encourage general people to learn. That it's only a few surahs. Okay, it's easier for me to memorize and understand. Okay? And the Sheikh mentions, you know, four things here. Reading it correctly to a teacher. Okay, they've translated it as two because in Arabic it's talqeen. Ala kulli hal, we can say three things. Firstly, reading it correctly to a teacher, learning how to recite it. Secondly, memorizing. And thirdly, understanding. So, you know, these three things are very, very important when we want to study these surahs. So even yourself, think, can you do these three things? Okay? Ideally, it should be in this order. But if not, if you understood it, but your recitation is not the best, I know how you memorized it, go seek to do it. Because these are from the most important surahs that every Muslim should know. Obviously, there are more important surahs, you know. You could say Ayat al-Kursi, ending of Surah Hashar, ending of Surah Baqarah. Okay, لا يكلف الله نفسا أو آمن الرسول. These are important, but obviously this, you know, small book, if you actually look at the size of the actual book, it's a pamphlet. The actual book itself is a pamphlet. Obviously with the explanation, it becomes a bit bigger. They used to sometimes give out these pamphlets in Medina. It was like literally this thin, really, really thin. But it's really important for us to learn these surahs. So obviously Surah Fatiha, because the greatest surah in the Quran, is a pillar of the salah. If you make mistakes in it, your salah is not accepted. You have to recite in every raka'ah. Okay? And, you know, these are enough for the general people for now. I mean, even if he wants to pray Qiyam al-Layl at night, even if he repeats these surahs again and again, it'll be enough for him. There's a hadith of Prophet ﷺ where a man was repeating the whole night Surah Ikhlas. And then the Sahaba told the Prophet ﷺ, and he said, إِنَّهَا لَتَعْدِدُ ثُلُثَ الْقُرْآنِ. It is equal to a third of the Quran. So these surahs have great meaning, great rewards in reciting. So we have to give importance to them. And generally we give importance to the Qur'an. You know, the Prophet ﷺ said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best of you are those who learn the Qur'an and teach it. And we know in the other hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that for every letter that you recite, you get 10 rewards. وَلَا أَقُولُ أَلِفْ لَا مِمْ حَرْفٌ لَكِنْ أَلِفٌ حَرْفٌ لَا مُنْ حَرْفٌ مِمْ حَرْفٌ. And Alif Lam Mim is not one harf. Alif is a letter, Lam is a letter, Mim is a letter. You get 10 for each of these separately. And we have to, you know, ponder over the Quran. You know, was Ibn Abbas said in line of poetry, جميل علومي في القرآن لكن تقاصر عنه أفهام الرجال. We mentioned this in the previous book. That all of the sciences, all of the knowledge is in the Quran. But the understanding of men is deficient. Okay, we have to ponder the Quran. This is why it has been revealed, and we're gonna speak about that as well. The Quran has been revealed so that we can learn it, ponder over it, and act upon it as well. That's why Ibn Qayyim in his Nuniyah, he says, this is not a line of poetry I'm adding. He says, فتدبر القرآن إن رمت الهدى فالعلم تحت تدبر القرآن. He says, فتدبر القرآن إن رمت الهدى فالعلم تحت تدبر القرآن. He says, ponder over the Quran if you are seeking guidance. For knowledge is beneath the pondering of the Quran. So ponder over the Quran if you are seeking guidance. For knowledge is beneath the pondering or the contemplation of the Quran. So we go to the Sheikh, his explanation. He says, clarification, the memorization should be according to the way of the companions. Remember, the first part was how the companions would do it. So how would the companions do it? We know in the famous narration of Abu Abdurrahman al-Sulami, he mentions this, that the Sahaba, every day, 10 verses. And with it, an explanation. And obviously the Sheikh mentioned Tafsir al-Sa'di. This is, he's trying to apply what the Salaf have done in our time. So how can we do it? How can we apply what the Salaf have done and acting upon it in the way while seeking the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So what would the Salaf, what would they do? They will learn 10 ayat, in the narration 10 ayat, and they would not go past it until they learn it and act upon it. Then they would go past it on the next 10 ayat. The Sheikh is saying here as well, take 10 ayat. You know, if there's too much, then maybe take, you know, go back or forth a little bit. But take a number of ayat, try to do 10, that's what the Salaf did. Understand it and use Tafsir al-Sa'di. We're gonna go to why Tafsir al-Sa'di, but very simple, very easy. It's not gonna take you long, like 10 ayat will take you 5 minutes, less than, maybe less. Okay, and then we act upon it while seeking the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanAllah, in Arabic, I know anyway, if anybody wants to listen to it in Arabic, it's actually recording verbally. So let me just play it for like 10 seconds.
فيعم جميع الأسماء الحسنى الله هو المألوه المعبود المستحق لإفراده بالعبادة لما اتصف به من صفات الألوهية وهي صفات الكمال الرحمن الرحيم اسمان دالان على أنه تعالى.
So as you can see, you know, it's recorded. Now this is Arabic, I'm not sure about the English, but those who are trying to learn Arabic, Sheikh Haytham would do this. When we did this book with him, he would say, listen to it. And subhanAllah, sometimes before coming to the lesson, if you were doing a certain surah, if I didn't have time to read the book, I would just listen. So whilst I'm going to the masjid, I would listen to it. And I would be able to listen to the whole surah from Tafsir al-Sa'di before going to the lesson. And in the lesson, I knew most of what the Sheikh was about to say. Not everything, but most of it, just by listening. So if anybody knows anything like that in English, they can let us know. But that is definitely there in Arabic, and this obviously shows the importance of the Arabic language and how much, you know, has been done for Islamic sciences in the Arabic language. Now, why should somebody start off with Tafsir al-Sa'di? Obviously, this is the whole name of Tafsir al-Sa'di. Tafsir Kareem al-Rahman fi Tafsiri Kalam al-Mannan. But you know, it's famously known as Tafsir al-Sa'di. Why? The Sheikh mentions a number of reasons, and we took this in the previous book also. The scholars have advised it. It's concise. It's easy and clear. It helps you act upon the Quran, and the author emphasizes upon Tawheed. And you can also add that there's very little differences of opinion that he actually mentions. So, I mean, Tafsir Ibn Kathir, very good, but he mentions this person said this, this person said this, this person said that, which can be very, very complicated. And what Sheikh Haytham Sarhan has done actually, when we are explaining this book, then, or these surahs, which explanation are we going to use for these surahs? Okay, we're going to go just through surah to Tafsir al-Sa'di. So all of this, so here we have surah al-Fatiha. This is translation of Tafsir al-Sa'di. Translation of Tafsir al-Sa'di. That's all we're going to do. We're just going to read it. I'm not going to add any extra explanation. We've taken it a little bit in depth in the previous book, But this book, just Tafsir al-Sa'di, and you're going to see how easy Tafsir al-Sa'di is. And how, you know, we're just going to read it and in like 5 minutes we can take the whole surah and move on. It's all Tafsir al-Sa'di. Yeah, all of it is Tafsir al-Sa'di. Right. And finally, we're just going to, again, we took this as well. How are the people when it comes to the Quran? How are the people when it comes to the Quran? Three types. Those who are negligent, those who go to extremes, and those who are in the middle. And those who are in the middle are the way how the Salaf were. So those who are negligent, they are the ones who abandon the Quran totally. They don't read, they don't memorize, they don't ponder, they don't act, they don't use it as a means of shifa, of treating sickness with it, as a cure. And those who go to extremes, they just read and memorize without pondering over the meaning or acting upon it. Okay? And then we have those who are moderate, those in the middle. They read, they memorize, they ponder, and they act upon it. And this is how the Salaf were. So, you know, everyone who claims to be Salafi, etc., you know, how evaluate yourself. How is your relationship with the Quran? You know, these are important lessons for the general Muslim. So we should know what's in this book. What does Inna Shani Akahu al Abtar mean? What does As-Samad? Allah As-Samad. Allah is As-Samad. What does As-Samad mean? Surah Ikhlas. Many people do not know that. So, you know, subhanAllah, we have to give a lot of importance to this. And we have already taken tafsir of these surahs before, so hence why we can go through this quickly. And all that we're going to do, we're just going to read, and then there's exercises toward the end, we can answer those exercises. So inshallah, I don't want to take long on this, on the tafsir of these surahs, inshallah. So today, what have we taken today? You know, we've taken, why should we study this book? What does this book consist of? Why do the ulama start with the basmala? How were the salaf with the Quran? Why do Tafsir al-Sa'di? And also, you know, we're going to read it and you'll understand why Tafsir al-Sa'di is chosen and how are the people when it comes to the Quran. And hopefully you've understood the importance of this book, and inshallah we'll take later. Now, I've got a little homework for you guys, and inshallah we're going to do this regularly in this book. If you go here, page, well, it's 40 in the PDF, I think 39, yeah, on the in the book itself. The Sheikh has questions. He has a lot of questions regarding the lesson that we have taken. So fill this in, inshallah, and in the beginning of next lesson, as our revision, we will take this surah as revision. We'll take these questions as revision. So who's the author? Why do we study the important lessons? What does the book consist of? And so on. Okay, so do the first 10, inshallah, and then surah Fatiha, when we take it, we can go through surah to al-Fatiha. And this book, again, is a very, very, it's an amazing book, a book which isn't given much importance to in the West. Okay, I've hardly seen people teach it, but it's very, very important. And it's for the general people. It shouldn't be made difficult. So we don't need to go into depth because the author made it for the general people, and we're going to teach it as we are teaching to the general people. And when you guys learn it, teach it to the people. It's something which the people know. Now, so we'll stop here, bismillah. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayka.